second of music with Bob Gunnell.
And today my guest is David Turner. He's the general manager of the Connaught Theatre in Worthing. He's the man who, when he began to take over his post, knew that behind him was a deficit of some £9,000 and the risk that the theatre in Worthing might well close. Today he is showing a credit balance of some £10,000 and indeed has now extended the season. David, this is quite a triumph.
Yes, it is. It's thrilling. It's thrilling that the theatre has taken such a terrific turn for the better. As you rightly say, 12 months ago, the theatre was closed, in actual fact, had this awful deficit, everybody was despondent, and I think a lot of people thought this was the end of live theatre in Worthing. But this year, it's a totally different story.
Well, we'll try and discover exactly how we got to that point as the programme goes on, David, but are you a man of the theatre?
Yes, I am. I was not exactly born in a dressing room, but almost. Both my parents were connected with the theatre. My father was stage manager at our local theatre in Kettering. My mother ran theatrical digs, so I really was just about born in the theatre.
What did that mean to be being brought up literally, as you say, in theatrical digs? Because one always gets this picture of theatrical digs and the people who come and go.
Well, I mean, there are digs and digs. I hope ours were the very best sort. And pros used to come back to us year after year, but one always had breakfast with the most interesting people possible. I mean, one week it might be a touring production of The Desert Song, so you had breakfast with the Red Shadow, or perhaps it was a variety show the next week, and a conjurer would be staying with us who would produce eggs from the most unlikely of places. So I couldn't help but really grow up and love the theatre. But with my father being at the theatre working, I mean, I remember things like Christmas Day, going up to stoke the boiler so that it was nice and warm in the theatre on Boxing Day for the Boxing Day crowds. It was a different atmosphere, of course, in the theatre in those days. We used to play 2 o'clock, 5 o'clock and 8 o'clock performances. I think today we would throw our hands up in horror and we should have equity jumping on us. But in those days, one was totally involved. Tours came in every week, you met wonderful people, some you still know, even after all these years. But I certainly really grew up in the theatre, and I know even our home had an influence on the people which came to stay with us. I mean, we had an impresario once who stayed with us, and we had in our front room some pretty awful pictures of Indians sitting in the moonlight, and he sat and looked at these awful pictures and created a show from them and put it out on the road, and it was indeed a very spectacular thing. I mean, to me they were pretty awful. I don't know whatever happened to them, they're probably thrown away, but he created a show from them which went out on the road. They were wonderful people, those touring people in those days. So I had to go into the theatre in the end. I mean, I started.
Were you an only child?
Yes, I was. Yes, I was. I mean, we were very fortunate. This was in the war years, and of course all the big shows went out on tour. When one thinks these days that the great big shows go to number one touring theatres, in those days, in the war years, all the big shows went even to number three theatres, and I suppose we were a number three theatre.
How big was this theatre?
Well, the theatre seated, I think, 1,131, which was quite big, but it, stage-wise, it was the most awkward theatre with a very shallow stage. But we coped. I mean, we had real ice shows on it. We had full circuses on it, ballet companies, opera companies, straight plays, musicals, pantomimes, the whole lot.
What's happened to it now?
It's bingo. Like so many it's
others.
Gone to bingo, which is a great tragedy, great tragedy.
Anyway, in the days that we're talking about, it was a great success, and you inevitably, presumably, had to go to the local school, although you obviously spent a lot of time in the theatre.
Yes, I did. I mean, I went to, I mean, we were non-conformists, but I went to the Anglo-Catholic school, not because we were Anglo-Catholics, but because it happened to be across the road, and I could stay in bed until 8:59 and just about scrape in for 9 o'clock. But of course it was at school where I started to become involved in dramatics, and I remember being quite a forceful character even in those days, and gathering together groups of my pals, and I was producing them and pushing them around in various theatricals in our own barn. We used to go in there every day in the freezing cold in the winter and do all sorts of splendid extravaganzas over piles of logs and heaps of rubbish and so on. But to us, it was great theatre.
This was it. Let's go to your first piece of music then, Dave. What have you chosen for us?
I've chosen a song from a current hit musical in London, which I love very much. I was very fortunate to go to its first night. The musical is Annie, and the song is Tomorrow.
Currently still running musical Annie. And there we are, we left you at school up there in Kettering, did we not? From the Anglo-Catholic school, the small one, to what, a grammar school?
To the Kettering Grammar School, yes. I gained my 11 plus, which in those days was called a scholarship and sounded very much grander. But I got my 11 plus and went to the grammar school. Where, alas, there wasn't the same interest in the theatre that I had in the school I'd been at previously, because in the junior school, I'd managed to land the lead in the play and was, ever since then, I've never wanted to play anything else but the lead. But in the school, there actually, in the grammar school, there was very little interest at that time in theatre. So I was, I think, a little bit stifled theatrical-wise there, but it was then that I began to be interested in the amateur dramatics in the town, and I began more or less my association with the operatic society in the town. But I had a very illustrious colleague in the same year at the Wellingborough Grammar School in David Frost. David and I became great friends because David's father was one of our Methodist ministers, and I was connected with the Methodist Church, and his father was Paradine Frost, whom we affectionately call Paradise Lost. Wonderful character. I look at David now on television and think often of his father, who was a lovely man. Wonderful man, very kind, very genuine, very humble. Really was a wonderful man.
At that point in your life, when you were still at school, I mean, how much part then did the Methodist Church play in your family life?
The Methodist Church actually played no part in our family life. Both my parents were nonconformists, my mother being Baptist and my father Congregational. And I've always been grateful all my life that they never ever forced it on me. I would sometimes go with my mother to chapel on a Sunday night and sit on those terribly hard wooden pews and listen to incredibly long sermons. I don't remember enjoying it. I don't remember not liking it. I didn't hate it. I didn't enjoy it. It didn't mean anything. But there came a stage in my life, I suppose when I was about 14, when I decided that I must either be for the church or against it. And it's odd that of the three main free churches, the Baptist, the Methodist and the Congregationalist, that I should choose the Methodist church. And I did choose it. I wasn't press ganged into going. I went of my own free will. All my friends at school, or quite a lot of them, were involved in the Boys' Brigade, which does a tremendous job. It didn't do much for me, alas.
Were you in the Boys' Brigade?
I joined the Boys' Brigade and wore those awful pillbox hats and loathed marching along the street. But it actually got me into the church and began, of course, an association which is still with me because I am very closely connected with Christianity. It's a very personal thing with me. And in those days, I was keenly interested not only in the message of the church and the beliefs of the church, but I was interested in the running of it. And I've always been a bit of an organiser, I'm afraid. And before very long, I was getting involved with lots of aspects of the church. I had, at that time, quite a good boy soprano voice. I used to do quite a lot of singing, and I went into the choir. And I got involved in the youth club, obviously. And I began to get very involved in the work of the church, probably too much so, at the expense of my education. It didn't exactly take me over, but I certainly was very, very keen. I tried to learn a lot about youth work. I was passionately interested in work with children. And I went to teach in the Sunday school, in the Methodist Sunday school, and found that I enjoyed it. I found that I got on a great deal with children, and I felt if I had some training, I would do even better. And I went in for a very long course run by the Methodist Youth Department on work with young people, all young people, I mean tiny children right up to teenagers, and I was then about 16, and studied and studied and studied, and it really led to, well, tremendous things, because I learned to speak in public, which is very important. They used in those days, and I don't think there is any more in the Methodist Church, an organisation with an awful title called the Wesley Guild, which is enough to put anybody off. But it was in the Wesley Guild that many, many people learnt to speak and talk, and I learnt to talk. I learnt to handle meetings and run meetings and chair meetings, and I found that it was being suggested to me that I went out to preach at the village chapels. And that in itself was quite an experience. I mean, obviously being very young and very inexperienced and learning the ropes and having really not a great religious background, I was sent to little village chapels to take the evening service, where I would probably have to walk 4 miles to get there in the pitch black. And having arrived at the village chapel, there would be two people there. One would be playing the organ and the other would be locking up. And there I would take the service and then walk the 4 miles back again.
Is this why you've chosen some music by Mendelssohn as your next piece?
Well, yes, it is in a way. I've chosen it for lots of reasons. I was in the chapel choir, and once a year, all the chapels in a Methodist circuit got together to sing. I mean, Methodist churches aren't one unit, they are a group of churches, which they call a circuit. And some of the membership in these village chapels was only 2 or 3, and couldn't ever have sung their hearts out at all in a year. So once a year, we got together in a great big rally, and part of the great moments of a rally was the singing of the mass choirs, and we all used to get together and practice like mad and sing one of the great choruses, which is why I have chosen Be Not Afraid from Elijah.
Thank you.
was part of Be Not Afraid from Mendelssohn's Elijah with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, all conducted by Sir Malcolm Sargent. Was there never a point, David, where perhaps you thought you ought to go into the ministry anyway, to become a minister?
No, I never thought that. A lot of people thought I should, and indeed a lot of people suggested to me indeed that I should go into the Methodist ministry. I was very fortunate. I think I did work hard and I did study hard in the work of the Methodist Church, and I don't know, it seemed to snowball. I was getting so many invitations and going all over the country preaching.
Just as a lay preacher.
Just as a lay preacher. I mean, I really was getting all the plum dates, all the big churches and all the great occasions. And I remember being packed out. I remember going to Leicester once to take special anniversary services, and you couldn't get a seat.
And still young.
And yes, I was probably 20. And I remember going into the great pulpit in the chapel, and people actually sat on every step up the way where I walked up. As soon as I walked into the pulpit, and people sat on every step of the stairs. I don't know. I've always had a very simple faith, and I think this simple faith...
Which
probably,
you were able to put over.
I think obviously. I probably must. I mean, I think there must have been a little bit of theatricality there. I don't know. But my faith has always been very simple. Often people say to me now about... religion, and I say, well, I have a marvellous relationship with God. I don't go down on my knees and pray, but we talk together quite regularly. And I know, even when I was appointed to the Connaught, I was working at the Theatre Royal in York, and the letter came asking me to go for the interview. And I didn't consciously go along to the Minster in York and kneel down and pray about the job, but I did remember going and sitting in the Minster and thinking about it. And I think there was great communication. The odd thing is that when I was up in York just before Christmas, having been working at the Connaught then for about 6 or 7 months, quite unconsciously I went back to the Minster and just said, thank you. It's a very simple faith I have. And I think it may have been this which
obviously,
I was going to say audiences enjoyed, congregations enjoyed.
But you had to live, for goodness sake. I mean, you were doing this in on Sundays over the weekends.
That's right.
So you'd left school.
I had left school.
So what were you doing?
Well, anyone, of course, who lives in Kettering in Northamptonshire, any Northamptonshire town, has to be involved with the boot and shoe industry in some way. And I went to work in one of the offices of a firm of leather dressers, which I hated. But the only reason it was bearable was I had my interests in the theatre and, of course, my interest in the Methodist Church, which was taking me to lots and lots of very exciting situations. I mean, I would fly off on a Friday evening to Eastbourne and go and lecture at a youth conference or something and come back late on Sunday night. And the next week, I remember going down to Westminster College in Oxford and lecturing to about 150 school teachers about children's club work. It was wonderful. The pace was terrific.
So how long did you stay in the boot and shoe?
I was there for 4 years, and I realised that I was in such a dead loss that I had to do something which I thought was much more creative. And I was very fortunate. I got a job with the local newspaper, which was the Northamptonshire Evening Telegraph, and I went into advertising and publicity with them, and of course I loved it. It was
totally different. More close to what you were doing.
Yes, and of course it was handling people and working with people, and was fascinating.
The Waltz from the Masquerade Suite by Cacciatore. Now, why have you chosen
that? Well, my father was stage manager for a time with the Northampton Repertory Company, which was and is one of the top repertory companies in this country. I learnt a lot of my knowledge of the theatre through my association with them. I saw every single production they ever did in all the years, and that was over a number of years my father was with them. And it was in the days of weekly rep, when you did a play every single week. And the standard was tremendous, but when I look back, I wonder sometimes whether some of it was perhaps a little dicey, because with repertory companies, one always chooses a piece of music to introduce the play and to set the mood. But I have an awful feeling we must have set an awful lot of wrong moods, because it always seemed to be the same piece of music which introduced a comedy, a farce, a classic, a Shakespeare, whatever, and it was nearly always the Waltz from the Masquerade Suite.
of the Waltz from the Masquerade Suite by Khachaturian, played there by the RCA Victor Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Kondratin. As all this was beginning to develop, David, I mean, did it never come to you that you really ought to go into the theatre?
No, it didn't at all. I joined the Operatic Society, and in Kettering had a most wonderful Operatic Society. It was very difficult to get in, and I didn't even dare hope that I would pass my audition, and much to my surprise, I did. And I joined the Operatic Society, but it still never actually occurred to me that I would wanted to be in the theatre myself. I didn't think I was good enough, basically, and indeed I wasn't. But then it did begin to appeal to me, and I thought, well, I was so green, and I was pretty awful, so I thought I've got to get some training. Well, I was so green that I thought you could go and do an audition for RADA or Lambda or Guildhall or one of the big drama schools and just walk in. And I had a pretty traumatic time going up for various auditions and, of course, falling flat on my face. But I still kept going. I mean, it didn't matter how rude they were to me. I still turned up 3 months later for the next set of auditions. But I did them very badly. I didn't tell a living soul that I was going for auditions. I didn't tell my parents. I didn't tell anyone. I just learnt my Shakespeare and or whatever I had to do for an audition. I can remember on the cricket field after cricket, when everyone else had gone, learning my lines and walking about, declaiming it to the birds or whoever was
around. But you didn't get into a drama
school. But I didn't. I mean, they quite
so
rightly turned me down. Well, I thought this was, I couldn't go on like this. I felt I had to be in the theatre, so I tried to explore locally a way in which I could learn stagecraft. And fortunately, in Kettering at that time was a very wonderful tutor called Elsie Bishnow. And dear old Elsie had been one of the tutors at the Guildhall School of Music and Drama and had retired. And she found that she wanted to keep her hand in, and she agreed to take half a dozen students and teach them theatre. And I was lucky enough to be one of those six. And I then spent all my spare time with her working and learning Shaw and Chekhov and how to speak and how to stand and how to sit and all the things one has to learn. She was a very wonderful person and a very kind person, actually a very honest person, and was frequently telling me how terrible I was. But then there came a stage when she started to say that I wasn't so bad after all. And it was being reflected in the work I was doing with the Operatic Society, and that my performances became stronger. But I still didn't see a way of taking this up professionally. And Kettering is like most industrial towns, there's very little opportunity for professional work. I mean, those Midland towns are rich in music and drama. I mean, the choral societies, and indeed, of course, Kettering has...
So what, London?
Yes. So I came to London, you see. I threw up my job. I got a job in London, an awful job. I was working in the Ministry of Housing and Local Government in Whitehall, and for my sins in the department labelled slum clearance. But it didn't really matter, because it afforded me the opportunity to be in theatre land, and I used every single penny I had to go to the theatre. I mean, I used to go without my lunch every day and spend my lunch money on a seat at the theatre, and I went every single night.
Some Elgar next.
Oh, yes. Well, I am a great loyalist, a great royalist, so I have to have something which makes me feel very patriotic, and there can't be many more English composers than Elgar. And I support the royal family enormously. I think they do a wonderful job. It was a great thrill and a privilege for me about 5 or 6 years ago to be presented to the Queen Mother in St. James's Palace. And she has that wonderful knack of making you, at that moment, the most important, in fact, the only person in the world. So, some Elgar, it's Salute d'Amour. It has a lovely story behind it, in that it was the piece of music which Elgar gave to his wife as an engagement present, the Salute d'Amour. Thank you.
part of Salut d'Amour by Elgar, played by the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Lawrence Collingwood. You're tuned to BBC Radio Brighton, and my guest in My Kind of Music today is David Turner, who is the general manager of the Connaught Theatre in Worthing. And we still actually haven't got you into the professional theatre at all. You're sitting there in the stalls or the gallery of the London Theatre, working in London, but what next?
Well, I was working very hard and spending all my money going to see the theatre. And I mean, I was lucky and saw most of the greats of that time. And then I decided that I couldn't afford to live in London any longer. I went back home. And of course, I still had this great link, even whilst I was in London, with the youth work I was doing. And I was very fortunate. I got a very good appointment with the Northamptonshire County Council as a careers advisory assistant in the new town of Wellingborough, which was coping with a terrific overspill from London. And I went there and worked, and I, of course, loved the work. It was work which was right up my street. I got completely involved in it. I was really having the best of both worlds. I was doing my amateur theatre and enjoying that enormously. And I was working at weekends in the Methodist Church, because at that time I was appointed youth officer for the whole of the Oxford and Leicester district of the Methodist Church, which was quite an appointment to have. And working professionally with young people. So I really was having quite a time. And then I decided after about 3 years that the theatre was for me, and I wasn't in the environment where I could become involved in theatre. And so I decided that I had to move. Now, there were two places I've always wanted to live. One was in London, which I did, and the other was Brighton.
Why Brighton?
Well, I'd always come here for holidays with my parents. My parents, I think, spent their honeymoon here, and I loved Brighton. We came quite a number of years for holidays, and so I came and lived in Brighton, and I got a job. I went to work at Lloyds Bank Registrar's Department in Worthing. And so here I was in Sussex, and of course I joined an amateur society in Worthing and became very involved. And after a time, it was suggested to me that I formed my own company, which at the time filled me with horror and said, no, good gracious, I don't want to do that. But then a lot of people said, well, if you do, we will come and support you. And so it's 10 years ago, 9 years ago since this happened, I called a meeting of anyone that was interested and said, look, it's been suggested to me that I form a society. If you would like to support me and back me, then I'm prepared to go ahead with this. And 22 people did, and quite a lot of those 22 people are still with me 9 years later, and it became the Worthing Light Opera Company.
Now, you've chosen something from The Sound of Music, haven't you?
Yes, I have.
Now, why?
Well, I had lots of reasons. It's as recent as last week that the Light Opera Company was presenting The Sound of Music. But it's a more personal thing than that. When I was going up and down to London, and indeed working in London, and still attending auditions, still ever being hopeful of getting into the professional theatre, I struck up a very great friendship with Constance Shacklock. When the London production of The Sound of Music opened, I tried to get first night tickets and couldn't, and got tickets for the third performance, and I was staggered to see that in the cast was Constance Shacklock. I had admired her in opera and, of course, singing at the last night of the proms. She played the Mother Abbess and she sang Climb Every Mountain, and I had never in my whole life been so thrilled with a performance. And I did something I had never done. I wrote to her and said thank you. And she wrote back and said, thank you for your nice letter. Come and see me. And we built a great friendship which still exists today. So I'd love to hear Constance Shacklock singing Climb Every Mountain.
Thank you.
climb every mountain, and that's Constance Shacklock there as the Mother Abbess from The Sound of Music, and it's the London cast of that particular production. So, working in a bank now, down here in Sussex, we're beginning to get closer to the Connaught Theatre as we go bit by bit by bit, now running your own Worthing Light Opera Company, but still not in the professional theatre, or working to any great degree in a lot of professional theatre, so something must have happened.
That's true, and yes it did. The very first production which the Light Opera Company presented was Ivan Novello's Glamorous Night, which I directed for them, and indeed I've directed every show they've ever done. But it was as a result of Glamorous Night, someone came to see it from Manchester who actually said to me, you should be doing this for a living. And I thought, well, I've been trying to say this to people for years. And I said, well, yes, probably, I don't know. I hope I've always had a large measure of humility in my life and still felt slightly inadequate. He said, you must. I suggest you get in touch with the National Operatic and Dramatic Association in London and see if they will take you on as a professional producer. Well, I didn't think it was very likely, but I wrote to them and they asked me to go and see them. And I went to see them and they had a reference from this gentleman. And they said, well, yes, we are very short of people doing this work. We will try and promote you. And of course I expected to be sent to the Nether Wallop Operatic Society somewhere, or some little tiny operatic society. And in actual fact, the very first appointment I got was with the York Operatic Society, playing the Theatre Royal York, which is one of the most beautiful theatres in this country. I gave up my job and accepted this appointment. It was about the only appointment I had to start with, and I really wonder now how I financially existed. But I went and I threw myself into this production, which is a production of Vivian Ellis's Bless the Bride, and much to my amazement, it was a tremendous success. And from that, everything else grew. I was suddenly inundated with offers of work for musicals in some...
They buy you in, the various amateur groups you in as a producer.
And here was I getting offers to direct shows in the Grand Theatre and the Opera House in Leeds and the Alhambra in Bradford and the Grand...
The great theatres
in the country. Suddenly from nothing in a 12-month to some of the great appointments in... I couldn't believe this, that it was all beginning to happen. And here was I then suddenly dashing about from one end of the country to another, working in some of the top theatres. And indeed, I mean, I worked under the most ideal of situations with the best of stage management teams, top orchestras, top conditions. I couldn't have asked for more. So,
but how did you actually work? Because with an operatic company, particularly with an amateur, the thing is in rehearsal for some time, isn't it?
That's right.
So at what point did you come in?
Well, I would have as many as 6 different shows in rehearsal at the same time. I mean, I have been known to rehearse actually 6 different shows in 1 week.
In different parts of the country?
In different parts of the country.
And moving around?
Yes, I mean, as far apart as Penzance and York. I would rehearse. In fact, even last year, I rehearsed Monday and Tuesday in Penzance and rehearsed Wednesday and Thursday in York, and then I went down to Somerset to Taunton.
Never tired?
Yes, absolutely shattered all the time. But it was I mean, it was just so wonderful to be working in the theatre. I don't think I gave money a second thought. I just enjoyed working hard. I met wonderful people. Absolutely wonderful people. I met some so-and-sos too, but I met wonderful people, and I mean, I was in the most tremendous of situations, and I learned a great deal, but I think I needed to learn a little bit of humility. I remember working in the York Theatre Royal, which is a beautiful theatre, and going straight from there down to Wales, to a mining community, to teach them a musical by Lionel Monckton. And when I arrived after the glories of York, I was, not to say, a little put out. I didn't relish it at all. It was a difficult hall to work in. It wasn't even a theatre. And I had to create theatre in this unhelpful situation. I mean, the hall itself was at the side of a zinc mill. And the other side of it was a cemetery, which was all overgrown, and there was the smoke from the pits and everything. I mean, it was a terrible situation. But on that first night, I shall never forget it as long as I live, when the curtain went up on the Arcadians, I suddenly realised that this was what it was all about. You see, in York, they get good theatre 52 weeks in the year, but in this little mining community just outside Swansea, it was the only week in the year they got theatre, and that was what it was all about, taking theatre to the people.
Not Lionel Monckton, but Ivan Novello you've chosen.
Yes, I have. I've chosen it for lots of reasons, because when the Light Opera Company was formed, I invited dear Olive Gilbert to be president of the Light Opera Company, and Olive was one of this world's loveliest people. She was kind and generous and sincere, and she accepted my invitation and became a great friend. I don't think there's anyone I have ever admired more. So I had to choose something today in memory of her. As you probably know, she died last week. And I've chosen from King's Rhapsody, Olive Gilbert singing Fly Home, Little Heart.
And that was Fly Home, Little Heart from King's Rhapsody, and it was Olive Gilbert. So how then did you eventually decide to come to the Connaught, for goodness sake, Dave?
Ah, well, yes. Here was I, trekking about all over the country, and it was, of course, obvious that I have great affection for my own local theatre. And it was always a source of sadness to me that the Connaught should go from one crisis to another, and indeed, through the last few years, it's had a few crises. And inwardly, I was longing to do something to help it. And of course, when the theatre closed this time last year, again, I felt great sadness that my own local theatre was going to go. I, alas, couldn't support it a great deal because I was never ever at home. But I did want very much to help in some way. And then in the stage appeared the advertisement for the appointment of a new general manager, which of course heralded the opening of the reopening of the theatre. And I think about 45 others, applied for the job. And much to my amazement, I was given an interview. And I mean, I don't know quite what I expected to come from it. I don't think I expected to get it. I'm certain I didn't expect to get it when I knew what time I was being interviewed at 9:30 in the morning, the first of the nine people being interviewed. I mean, whoever goes first never gets the job. And I remember going up to the town hall for the interview being absolutely scared stiff. I really was scared because I did want the appointment very much, because I felt I could do something for the theatre, and I hoped that the opportunity would come my way to do just that. Anyway, I was called to go into the room for the interview and was confronted with, I think, 16 people, which terrified me even more. But inwardly I was thinking, right, here I am. And when I came out, I thought, well, if I've lost it, I've lost it, but I couldn't have interviewed any better. I don't know whether someone up there loved me or what, but probably I answered the questions in the way that they should have been answered, because at 20 past one, I was called back in to say I had been given the appointment, and I couldn't have been more thrilled. Actually, I was suffering from the flu at the time. I was really feeling pretty rotten.
So there you were, pitched into what inevitably was a hot seat.
Oh yes, very much so.
So how did you face the challenge? What went through your mind?
Well, I think quite wrongly, the first thing which went through my mind was I knew of all the people that would be waiting for me to fall flat on my face, because I suppose looking at it quite detached, it was probably a strange appointment. I had actually no managerial experience. I had had a great deal of experience of budgeting and publicity and running a company, because I had to do all that with the big amateur companies playing in big theatres. But to actually have my own theatre was something I hadn't had any experience of, but the board put its trust in me, and I must say they have supported me tremendously in the months I've been at the theatre.
So what did you do?
We had to like Fagin in Oliver, we had to review the situation. Nicholas Young, who is the artistic director, of course, has been at the theatre for a number of years, and Nick and I got together immediately. Within 20 minutes of me being appointed, he sort of collared me and dragged me to a pub, and we were already talking policy. And we had to instigate new schemes, new ideas, a fresh approach, look at the theatre as a whole and plan for a success. There couldn't be a failure. If there had been a failure this time, I firmly believe it would have been the end of the Connaught forever. But I think we both had a measure of inspiration. We've worked extremely well together. We planned a new approach to publicity. We've planned and we discuss at great lengths the actual programmes. Both Nick and I have experience of theatre in different ways, and I think combining that interest of the theatre has resulted in a very well-balanced programme of plays, which we take to our Board of Governors for their approval and discussion, and again they support us totally. I think the balance of plays has been excellent. And we've also instigated a subscription scheme, which means you can book not for one play, but six in a season. And by booking for six in a season, you get them at a slightly reduced rate. So we need to plan well ahead. And probably in the past, the planning wasn't so far ahead as it might have been. This has brought in a tremendous response. I mean, currently we're coping with a subscription scheme which isn't far off 3,500. So whilst we have sold 3,500 seats for the first play in the season, we have also sold 3,500 seats for the play in July.
Which is a very warming sort.
It's a very heartwarming situation.
Pineapple Pole, last piece of music.
Yes. Well, I have to have a piece of music which is associated with the Connaught. Nick is extremely good with the selection of music he chooses to introduce each play. He doesn't use the same piece like we seem to use at Northampton. And I'd like the piece of music which introduced the very first play when we reopened the theatre. It was a great moment for all the theatre staff when the curtain went up on An Ideal Husband, and the music which introduced that very first performance was the opening dance from Pineapple Pole.
Thank you.
There we go. That's the beginning from the ballet Pineapple Bowl, based, of course, on the music of Sir Arthur Sullivan, Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Charles McCarris. And the Connaught Theatre, let us admit it now, thanks to you, I think, David, it must be, because it wasn't until you got there, is now a success. What happens?
From now on, well, I hope a continuation of the very happy atmosphere which pervades the theatre. I'm very old-fashioned, really, with my theatre. I think theatre starts not when the curtain goes up, but when you push the door open to walk in. And one of the lovely things which has happened in the months that the theatre's been reopened has been the building up of relationships with the public. Worthing is a town which identifies with personalities, and we have made ourselves very much available to the public. They feel they can come and talk to us. They can feel they can come and tell us it's a wonderful show. They can also tell us when they don't think it's a wonderful show, and do. There is an excitement about the theatre. The whole place is alive, and we must continue to keep it alive. I think it is a great challenge. We are planning well ahead. We have a wonderful season of plays coming. We have some wonderful artists. It's the happy amalgamation of our resident company and star names. I mean, currently we're playing, opening this week, The Kingfisher with three lovely people: Michael Denison, Dulcie Gray, Robert Fleming, three of the great names of the theatre. And the result is that the theatre seats are filled night after night after night, and long may it continue.
David, it's obvious that over your life you've been moving around, groping around, going in a direction, sometimes planned, sometimes not. Do you feel that perhaps you've now arrived at what you've been striving for all the time?
Probably. Yes, I think I probably have. I think all of our life is planned. I'm a great believer in that. Yes, I think I was meant to come to the Connaught. It may mean that I'm meant to stay at the Connaught. I don't know, but I do think life is planned, and I'm very happy that it's worked out the way it has.
David Turner, thank you very much indeed. General Manager of the Connaught Theatre in Worthing, thank you for coming in and introducing your kind of music.
My Kind of Music was presented by Bob Gunnell. And the guest in the programme next week, at the same time, is Keith Carlisle, who is the headmaster of Seaford Head School.